Good morning, everybody.
Good morning. Right. Good. God bless all you right. All.
Martha made the drive from Richmond this morning, I see.
Yeah.
She and Nancy's here. Good to see you all. May have some other new ones. Well, she's not new, but may have some other folks that's driven a good distance to be here. We appreciate you being here.
Good crowd this morning.
Yeah.
Looking good.
Everybody got their mask on?
I know.
Mask. Doing good.
Yeah. Waiting for that Damascus. You're not going
to
do that
yeah,
again,
hopefully
are you?
We'll be on the road to Damascus one of these days, right?
Yeah, just don't do that again.
But, got Thanksgiving coming up.
I know. Praise the Lord. We have much to be thankful for.
That's right. The old pilgrims. Been thinking about the old pilgrims. Been
reading. Oh, you have, huh? Well, what about the pilgrims?
Well, I don't know. Just pull the old Compton's dictionary or encyclopedia out and sort of read a little bit about the pilgrims, about the old Mayflower.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah.
That's a big ship, you know.
It was. Yeah, it was.
Big ships, they don't sail this way anymore.
That's true.
Yeah,
they don't.
You know? Yeah. I don't see them down Cave Run.
No. Probably no, haven't seen one like the Mayflower down there.
You know, those college students, they like them ships.
They do?
Yeah. Scholarships.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, boy.
Over in Moorhead, you should know all
do.
About that. They like those scholarships.
They do. They do like those ships.
Yeah, the old pilgrims. What do you think about their uniforms or their outfits?
Yeah, I like those.
Okay.
I like their hats.
Well, you know, they had problems early on. Them uniforms, they sort of embarrassing. They had a lot of broken legs and ankles turned and all that.
Did they?
Yeah.
Yeah, why?
Well, I don't know. They're... Yeah, you shouldn't ask.
Yeah.
Well, the
this
trousers.
This is my role to ask. Yeah.
The trousers, they couldn't keep the trousers. They kept slipping down. They caused them to have an accident.
Yeah.
Historians finally figured it out.
Yeah.
He was wearing a belt buckle on a hat.
Oh, boy.
Oh, well.
Thousand comedians out of work now with COVID. And
well, just a little bit about Thanksgiving, folks. Yeah. We're here to celebrate. Like you say, have a great time.
Yeah.
Last week.
It's going to be a great day.
Look at all these boxes up here, man. Fantastic.
Yeah.
I know you're going to share some good
news. We are.
Later
this
on.
Is really a good day for us. Operation Christmas Child, we're going to send these around the world. This is a great day. We'll have a little bit of a ceremony. Sherry's got some things for us after a while. Incredible.
All right. Fantastic. And I know last week talking about the warnings, two warnings
that
Jesus gave during his sermon. And they were false prophets and false professions.
That's right. Amen.
And so anyway, what do we got today?
Well, today, interestingly enough, I know everybody's just sitting on the edge of their chair waiting for lesson number 18 and the final
18.
One
wow.
of the Sermon on the Mount. But today we got to pause. We're going to look at reasons for Thanksgiving.
Absolutely.
Reasons
well, that should
for Thanksgiving.
It should be easy. We all got
it
much to be,
be.
Thankful
we,
for.
We could count our blessings, and it'd take us a long, long time.
Absolutely. All right. I think we're ready to have church.
Yeah, I think we're
all
ready. Yeah.
Let's just praise the Lord this morning.
Amen.
Can we do that? Everybody knows this. Just praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let's just lift our voice toward heaven and praise the Lord. Let's just praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let's just lift our voice toward heaven and praise the Lord.
Can you sing a verse, Mary, please?
Oh, we thank you for your kindness. We thank you for your love. We have been in heavenly places, felt blessings from above. We have long shared the good things the family can afford. Let's just lift our hearts toward heaven.
Let's see Mary. Are you glad to see her today? Let's just praise the Lord. Praise.
and His grace set me free, and someday I shall stand by His side.
Here we go now.
I am blessed. Every day that I live, I am blessed. When I wake up in the morning, till I lay my head to rest, I am blessed.
I am blessed.
I am blessed.
I am blessed. I have shoes for my feet. I have plenty to eat and a home in heaven by and by. Brothers and sisters on this earth, they are mine by my new birth, and we shall share in that home beyond the sky. Here we go now. I am blessed.
I am blessed.
I am blessed.
I am blessed. Every day that I live, I am blessed. When I wake up in the morning, till I lay my head to rest, I am blessed.
Amen. We are all blessed. We all have so much to be thankful for, and among those things is the opportunity to be part of Operation Christmas Child, to be able to provide gifts to kids around the world, to be able to be part of a ministry that's giving them the gospel. Some of these kids will receive, most of them probably, a gift for the first time in their lives. And they'll receive the gospel maybe for the first time in their lives. So at this moment, you see all these boxes, and they're going to be shipped here soon. As a matter of fact, after the service, I'm going to ask a lot of you to help us. We've got the U-Haul here, and we're going to load them up right after the service so they can be shipped out. But I asked Sherry to come and give us a report, and then we're going to have a special prayer for them before they leave here. And I just want you to know how much we appreciate Sherry and her work. She is a leader. She organizes this and makes sure things are going well. And no telling how many gifts she's bought with money people have given and other things. This is an overwhelming job. And not only for our church, but we're a center for bringing them in, whatever the word is. Drop-off center, okay, that's good. But she does so much work. I appreciate everything she does. So please show her some appreciation, would you? And Sherry.
I just want to share just a little bit about what we've been doing. You know, we've been doing this for a year. We start as soon as it's over the front, you know, when we got our boxes out last year, we started getting ready for the new year. John 14:16 says, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And our job is to tell and share the good news with as many people as we can. And Operation Christmas Child allows us to partner with churches around the world so that the good news is going out.
Amen.
I read a statistic just a while ago that I guess I knew it, but I hadn't thought about it. 1.9 billion children in the world below the age of 15. That's 25% of the world's population that we have the potential to reach through a gospel opportunity or a shoebox so that they can hear about Jesus. Last year, 10.5 million shoeboxes were collected and distributed, and 2.2 million decisions for Jesus were made as a result of those
Amen.
Shoeboxes. Statistically, for every 100 shoeboxes, 21 reported decisions for Christ are made. Every 14 seconds, a child becomes a follower of Christ through the Greatest Journey Discipleship Program. And statistically, 7 to 10 people hear the gospel from one shoebox.
Amen.
So, how many people are we able to reach from just our little place here in Frenchburg? We have collected, even though we've had lots of obstacles and things this year, we've collected, as of right now, 810 shoeboxes.
Amen.
That means from right here in Frenchburg, we are able to reach 5,600 to 8,100 people for the gospel around the world. So
Amen.
That's pretty amazing.
Amen.
I do want to just say thank you to everyone who has donated, whether it was donated items, donated shipping. And back to the 810, all the shipping costs has been covered for that.
Amen. There you go.
Of course, if you packed a shoebox, if you prayed about our shoebox ministry, or if you volunteered, there were tons of volunteers all year, especially this last week. It's been amazing. I'm just so thankful for that. So I'll just leave with this last verse, Matthew 19:14. Jesus said, "Let the little children come to me and do not hinder them, for such belongs the kingdom of heaven."
Amen. Sherry, God bless you, and thank you so much. And thanks to all our volunteers. Sherry, hold on just one moment. Thanks to all of our volunteers, everybody who helped, and things she said, all of those things. Thank you so much for this tremendous ministry. And 810 shoeboxes through this virus and all the things is absolutely incredible. Thank you for that, and thank you for the shipping that's been covered. Incredible thing. This is of God. This is a ministry He loves, and will reach so many people. So I'm going to ask our deacons to mask up and to come forward, and we're going to have prayer. And Sherry, I want you just to be with Joe there as we pray together. All of our deacons, would you come? And we're just going to have special prayer for these and make sure we keep our space and have our masks. And all right, we're so thankful for this opportunity. Would y'all, all of you, join us in prayer this time? Father, we thank you so much that you love us. We're thankful that you sent Jesus to be our Savior. We're thankful for the gospel of how He died for our sins, was buried and rose again to give us eternal life. And Father, your love and your gospel is what we want to send around the world. We thank you for the opportunity to be part of Operation Christmas Child, and we ask your blessings upon Franklin Graham and this whole Samaritan's Purse ministry. Thank you for the opportunity to be part of making a difference in the lives of children. And Lord, we ask you to bless these boxes. Everyone that's before us here, we pray, would touch a heart, would lead a soul to Christ. I pray that every one of them would demonstrate your love as you gave Jesus, and would give them an opportunity to hear the gospel, and that many would be saved, children and their families, because of these boxes that we're sending. Thank you so much for Sherry and for all the volunteers, for all the givers, those who brought boxes, those who prayed for them, everything that people did. Thank you. And Father, I pray that you would bless every box. And in heaven, it's going to be a joy when we find out those who were saved because of these boxes. Thank you, Father. Guide them, protect them, and get them into the hands of children around the world. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you.
Let's give another hand for Joe and Sherry on taking the lead on this. All right. You can join in on the course. It's just tradition sometimes. Thanks, Abe. When upon life's billows you are tempest tossed, when you are discouraged, thinking all is lost, count your many blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord has done. All right. Count your blessings, name them one by one. See what God
other lands than gold. Think that Christ has promised you his wealth untold. Count your many blessings money cannot buy. Your reward in heaven nor your hope on high. On the course again.
Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God has done.
Count your blessings, name them one by one.
Count your many blessings, see what God has done.
Amen. Okay. Not only this week, but throughout the year, right?
Amen.
Need to count your blessings.
Upon me as I struggle along. They say I have nothing, but they are so wrong. In my heart there's rejoicing. How I wish they could see. Thank you, Lord, for your blessing. There's a roof up above me.
There's a good place.
I've a good place to sleep.
There's food.
There's food on my table and shoes on my feet. You gave me your love, Lord, and a fine family.
Sing it now.
Let me just run over a few announcements quickly. Tonight, of course, our evening worship service at 6 o'clock. We continue our study of Revelation. And then this week, no Wednesday night services, but Tuesday. Not Wednesday, Tuesday, we'll have a praise service, 7 o'clock here in the gym. Now, this is just a service where if you have a testimony, you have verses, you have a song, just a way of saying thanks. We're not going to ask the Lord for anything. We're just going to praise Him, thank Him, worship Him because of all of His goodness and because of who He is. Let me also remind you about the One Call service that you get. Some of you get by text, some of you get by email, some of you get by phone call. Probably some of you get them all. But if you're not signed up, we can send things out quickly and let people know what's going on, like the services this week and so forth. And Johnny has a sign-up sheet over there. If you're not on the one call yet, sign up. Or if your number has changed, your email's changed, you have some kind of change, please let him know by signing that up. And then we have coming up next Sunday a teachers volunteers meeting about Sunday school and children's church. We have a hanging of the greens or fifth Sunday singing. We'll have something going on. And then the angel trees, I don't know. I think there's still some left back there on the nursing home tree. But check those. Make sure we have all those covered. And then the food ministry, the food baskets, all that. Chelsea has a note there, a list of all the things we need. So please help us with those. And then Ann and her family want to thank everyone for prayers, thoughts, phone calls, cards, and all the love for John during this time and for all the church has done, and ask we continue to pray for them during this time. And God bless you, Ann and family. And all right, I think that's everything then. All right. God bless you.
All right, just before the message, here's another song we got to do around this time, right? Miss Nellie, we try to do the old social distance thing, but here's a song. Everybody enjoys this song. And it's very appropriate this time of the year. All right.
Surely good to be in God's house this morning. Don't you agree?
Have you counted your blessings lately? I mean, have you really? Have you? I know we're all thankful, right? But have you really counted all your blessings? Today, I want us to look at some reasons for Thanksgiving. And we all have a whole bundle of things to be thankful for. And we should never have to have a day declared to be thankful. But I'm sure glad there is a national recognition that we need to be thankful. I wonder, though, for those who don't know God, who don't know the Lord Jesus Christ, who have no faith, who do they thank? I mean, you just say, well, I'm thankful, but to whom? I mean, who did it? I mean, it's just say, I'm thankful. Yeah, but who are you thankful to? And what did they do to make you thankful? We just can't say I'm thankful. There has to be a recipient of our thanksgiving. And of course, we know who that is. But we as Christians especially should always have, you've heard the phrase, an attitude of gratitude. This should be all the time. The Bible says in 1 Thessalonians 5:18, it says, in everything give thanks. It doesn't say give thanks for everything, but in everything, in all of our circumstances throughout life, be thankful. Because of all things, we have the Lord Jesus Christ. If we have nothing else, we have everything because we have Him. In Psalm 100, it says, make a joyful noise unto the Lord all your land. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before His presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, He is God. It is He that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are His people and the sheep of His pasture. Enter into His gates with thanksgiving, into His courts with praise. Be thankful unto Him and bless His name. For the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting, and His truth endureth to all generations. In Psalm 103, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless His holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all His benefits. Father, we thank You for Your goodness. We thank You for Your truth. We thank You, Father, for all that You do for us, especially for the Lord Jesus. And Lord, we thank You for Your Word and its truth and its power. And I pray that as we study together, that You would teach us and that every word spoken would be Yours and not mine. And Father, I pray that we'll be people above all others, that we are thankful to You for all that You've done and all that You do every day. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. Now, all of His benefits. Let me just ask you this. I know you thank Him for all His benefits. I know you're careful to remember all of His benefits, all the things that He's done. But let me ask you this. Have you ever just thanked God for Himself? Have you ever just prayed, God, I thank You for You? Not I thank You for Your goodness, or I thank You for Your blessings, or I thank You for salvation, or I thank You for this, I thank You for that, but I just thank You for You, who You are. Because it's because of who He is the reason He does the things He does. And so we need to be aware of Him and be thankful for Him. Because it wasn't for Him, we have no hope. And if He wasn't the way He is, we wouldn't have all that He does. I don't know if that makes sense to you, but I hope you get that. That we're just trying to be, we want to be thankful for Him, for God Himself. And so, just listen to these things. If we give God thanks for His person, His power, His presence, His purposes, and His provision. Just think about those things as we thank God for Himself, for who He is, and then for what He does. First of all, His person. We need to be thankful for His person. that He is God. It said in Psalm 100, "Know you that the Lord, He is God." We're not. He is. He made us. Now, unfortunately, in our day, people do make God. Not the real God. Not the one true God. But because they want a God to fit their lifestyles, they do make a God. They make a God in their image rather than us being made in the image of God. But the fact is, God is God and we're not. So we need to be thankful, but that this one that we know through the Lord Jesus Christ, is God. Now, why is that important? Because as God, He can do all things. As God, He can handle our lives. As God, He is in control of all things. COVID-19 is not in control. Now, why He's allowing this, I don't know what His plans are. I don't know what's going to happen. I don't know the end result of this, but I do know He's in control. The Lord is the light of my salvation. Whom shall I fear? And so we have nothing or no one to fear. There are things that happen in this world, things that happen in our lives, but we can be thankful that He is God, and that means He's in control and He can do all things. He has a plan, and that plan will be fulfilled. And so thankful, first of all, He is God. Then we need to be thankful that He is good. If He wasn't good, we'd all be in trouble. But He is good. And these are things you need to remember, even when good things aren't happening. You know, He's promised to work all things out for good, but not that all things that come in our lives are good. This is a fallen world. It has a curse on it. Bad things are going to happen. And we can't be surprised when bad things happen. But God is good. He is always good. That is His nature. That is His character. That is His person, that God is good. And it says in Scripture, in Psalm 100, verse 5, "For the Lord is good." In Psalm 136 in verse 1, "Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for He is good." So be thankful for the person of God, that He is good, that He is God, He is good, He is gracious. He is gracious. By grace are you saved through faith, and not of yourselves, it's a gift of God. We're saved by grace. We're sustained by grace. He is a God of grace. And He is gracious to all of us. He is patient. He is kind. He is loving. He is gracious. God is love. You know the scriptures say in 1 John 4:8 and verse 16, it just simply says this: God is love. That's His character. That's His nature. That's His person. God is love. Now, He didn't just say it, though. He demonstrated it. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. He sent Him to be our Savior, die in our place for our sins. God is love. He demonstrated His love in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Romans 5:8. And so God is God. He is good. He is gracious, He is love, and He is holy. God is holy. Now that might scare you to death, that He is holy. But let's look at 1 Peter and talk about this just a bit. 1 Peter 1, verses 15 through 17. "But as He which hath called you is holy, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation. Because it is written, be ye holy, for I am holy." When you know that God is holy, that means that He is a God of character, of integrity, of truth. He will never, ever let you down. He will never fail. He will never lie. He will never fail to keep a promise. He is holy. That speaks of His character, of who He is. You can always count on God. Always, always, always count on God. So be thankful. Give thanks to God for His person. Be thankful. Give thanks to God for His power. We have His power at our disposal. In Psalm 46:1, you know, we quote this all the time. The Lord is our refuge and our strength. He not only is our protection, He is our strength. So whatever you need to do, He is our refuge and our strength. Not only that, the Bible says that we should, in Ephesians 6:10, we should be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. We can't do all things, but He can do all things. The Bible says in Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. You are never intended to do things on your own. You are intended to know Christ as Savior and to depend on Him. We're to fight the spiritual warfare in His power. We're to live our lives in His power. We're to do all the things that He has us to do in His power. We ought to be thankful that we have His power available to us. You can do whatever you need to do, whatever He asks you to do, you can do because of His power. Be strong in the Lord, not in yourself. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Be thankful for His power. Be thankful. Give thanks for His presence. Have you ever thought about this really and just given Him thanks? The rest of 46:1, Psalm 46:1 said, the Lord's our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Now, do you really let this become real to you that He is always here? And are you thankful that He is always here? Do you ever think about, when you're thinking about all the things you're thankful for, we think about things like, well, thank you for our home, thank you for our food, thank you for our clothing, thank you for our kids, thank you for our grandkids, thank you for our car, thank you for our job, thank you for this, thank you for that. And all those are important. Don't forget all of His benefits, the Bible says. But what about just the fact of His presence? You are never, ever, ever alone. God is always there, always. Think of how powerful that is and how wonderful that is, that God, the Creator, is always there with you and for you. Be thankful for His presence. He will never leave us. In Hebrews 13:5 it says He will never leave us nor forsake us. Look at this verse with me. There's three parts of this. I want you to see this. I'm sure we've discussed it before, as we have about everything, but look in this verse. This is one of the most powerful verses. If you get this, it's powerful in your life. Hebrews 13:5. Let your conversation be without covetousness, and be content with such things as you have. For He hath said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. Now look at this. Number one, write these three things down about this verse. Number one, don't covet. Simple as that, don't covet. Don't always be looking for what someone else has. Don't always be trying to get what someone else has or to be like someone else. Be content. God knows what your needs are. He has a plan for your life. Be content with who you are and what you have and what God is doing in your life. So don't covet, but be content. Number one, don't covet. Number two, be content. Don't try to be someone else. Don't try to have someone else's things. Don't want what someone else has. But be content with who you are, what God has for you, what God has given you, what God is doing in your life. Be content. And number three, because you have Christ. It says He will never leave you nor forsake you. You have Christ. So you have everything. Don't covet. Be content. You have Christ. Be thankful that you have the Lord Jesus Christ. And that His presence is such that He will never leave you nor forsake you. Never. Ever. Whatever you do. If you are saved, if you have ever been saved, you are saved. And He has never left you, nor will He ever. Be thankful for His presence. And then be thankful for His purposes. We don't always understand His purposes. We don't always know what He's doing in our lives. But we do know that He is working in our lives. We do know He's in control. First of all, He has given us a hope and a future. The great verse of Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, saith the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end. Or what that means is to give you a future and a hope. Your hope is in the Lord Jesus Christ. And He has a future for you out there. He has a plan for your life. He has a purpose for you. You are unique. He has made you uniquely. There's no one like you. And He has a plan for your life. And you need to be submissive to His plan. To do His will. And to submit yourself to whatever He wants to do with you and with your life. So He has a hope and a future for every single person. He also, one of the things we know He wants for you is He wants you to be saved. In 1 Timothy 2:4 says that He would have all to be saved. He wants you to be saved. And John 3:16, quoted a minute ago, that if you believe, it says, everyone who believes will not perish but have everlasting life. Whosoever, whoever it is that believes, that trusts Christ as Savior, will be saved. He has, look in Psalm 103:2-3-4. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all His benefits, who forgiveth all thine iniquities. Look in verse 4, who redeemeth thy life from destruction. Look at verse 5, who satisfieth thy mouth with good things. He wants you to be saved. He wants you to experience forgiveness. Be thankful for the Lord's purposes in your life. Maybe you haven't figured it out yet on all those things. You do know He wants you to be saved. You do know He wants you to be like the Lord Jesus Christ. Now I can't tell you, and you don't know perhaps yet, where He wants you to live, what He wants you to do, what His ministry for you is. Hey, there's all kinds of things. And you think right now you may be content exactly where you are. Well, I know I'm supposed to be here. I know I'm supposed to do these things and all that. And He may come and speak to you and take you somewhere else. He may have another plan for you. Now, you'd be thankful for that, wouldn't you? You wouldn't say, well, no, I'm not going, am I? Would you? You wouldn't, would you? If the Lord said, I want you to go here and do this, you would say, right, I will. Okay, good. Praise the Lord. You wouldn't say, well, no, I've settled here. I got my house here. My family's here. You wouldn't rebel, would you? We need to be thankful for God's purpose in our lives. Here's what you have to believe. God is right, and I'm wrong. We always have to trust Him and believe He is right. We have to trust Him. He loves us. He has a plan for our lives. And then here's another purpose He wants for you. In John 10:10, the Lord Jesus said, "I am come that you might have life and have it more abundantly." You know what He wants for you? He wants your life to be full. That abundant life means life to the full. He wants you to be, to have a life that's full of joy, that's full of peace, that's full of living, and taking advantage of the opportunities He's given you. We don't know how long we have. Hey, the Lord Jesus may come back today. Would that not be great or what? Would that not be great if He'd just come and take us all home and take the virus away? I mean, we're praying, "Lord, take the virus away." Maybe we should be praying, "Lord, take us away. Leave the virus if you want to, but take us away." There's no COVID-19 in heaven. There's no COVID of any number in heaven. There's no disease. There's no sickness. There's no broken hearts. There's no loneliness. There's nothing like that in heaven. It's just all good. It's all good. So why don't we think about heaven more? We tell people it's so good, right? We talk about why it's so good, but then we're afraid to go. Aren't we? Now, I'm not saying that you go on ahead without us. And we don't know when God's going to take us home. But we ought to rejoice that we're going to heaven. He's come. We have life, abundant life, eternal life. Here we can have joy. Our lives can be full. And we can be happy. And we can have meaningful, fulfilling lives. But the fact is, where He really wants us is home. Is home. Be thankful for the purposes He has in our lives, whatever they are. And then for His provision. The Lord will supply all your needs. There you go. Period. He will supply all your needs through Christ Jesus. Philippians 4:19. He said, if you remember in our study on the Sermon on the Mount, He knows what you need before you ask. Now, He wants you to ask. He wants you to communicate. He wants you to stay in touch with Him. But He already knows what you have need of. Not only today, He knows what you need tomorrow. Are you thankful for that? That He meets all of your needs, whatever it is. It may be a physical need, it may be a financial need, it may be an emotional need. But whatever your needs are, He has promised. And remember the part about He is holy. He won't break His promise. He'll always keep His word. He said He would meet your needs. That means He will meet your needs. He will meet them. Now, the next step of that is, And again, we've talked about this, He will also give you the desires of your heart. If you delight, the Bible says in Psalm 37:4, if you delight in the Lord, if you delight in Him, He will give you the desires of your heart. He will change your heart. He will change your thinking. When you delight in Him, He will truly make you so different. And all your wants and desires will change. But He's promised He'd not only meet our needs, but He will meet the desires of your heart if you delight in Him. If you thanked Him for His provision. There's another thing He has provided. You know this verse. You heard Sherry quote it a while ago. In John 14:6, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Have you thanked God not only for Jesus, but have you thanked Him for the truth? Have you thanked Him for the truth? Have you thanked Him for the truth about yourself? Have you thanked Him for the truth about life? Have you thanked Him that you have had the opportunity to know the truth? You know, around the world, and even in the United States, there are some people who are so enslaved by deception, by lies. They don't know the truth. Have you thanked the Lord that you know the truth? The Lord Jesus is the truth. And when you know Him, and He said, you continue in My word, you'll know the truth, and the truth will set you free. You think of all the people bound by lies and deceit, and by all the things they think is true, and it's not. We have so much to be thankful for. This morning, I just want us to be thankful for God. We need to thank Him for Himself. God, I thank You for You. I thank You for who You are. I'm thankful I know You. I'm thankful. I'm thankful for Your person, for Your power, for Your presence, for Your purposes, for Your provision. I am thankful, God, for You. I know You personally. I know You love me. I know You're good. I know You have a plan for my life. I know You're going to meet all of my needs. I'm just thankful for You, God. Whatever else I have or I don't have, I'm not even counting those today. There are many. I'm just thankful for You and that I know You. If you don't know God today through Christ, you need to. It'd be your greatest decision and your greatest blessing. God loves you. He sent His Son to be your Savior. If you'd turn from your sins and just trust Christ who died for you and rose again, just trust Him. He'll forgive you and save you and give you eternal life. And you can live this life with confidence, trusting Him, knowing that whatever happens in this life, you're going to heaven. And in this life, He's always going to meet every need. He's never, ever going to abandon you. If you're not saved, you need Jesus. If you are saved, let's be thankful people. I mean, really thankful people, not lip service people, not going through the motions people, but thankful people. And before we start counting the benefits, before we start counting our blessings, let's be thankful for Him, for God, who He is, and what He's done. Father, we thank You for You. We're thankful for who You are. We're thankful for all You do. We're thankful for the Lord Jesus. We're thankful for the Holy Spirit. We're thankful for Your powerful word. Father, if there's someone here today who's not saved, or someone who's watching or listening to the program, we pray they would be saved. I pray all of us as Christians would be so thankful for you. So thankful for who you are and how you love us and provide for us and help us to tell others about you. We pray in Jesus' name, amen.